guy recording it is.
So, this month's sword is the ever popular Buster sword. This version of it is from the remake that's coming out, which is not out yet. So all of the me looking at it has been based on a small handful of trailers. But it seems like it's a mashup between the Crisis Core version and the original FF7 one from a bajillion years ago. In a strange turn of events, this sword isn't so much a commission as a collaboration. Jared Buick of NewEthic.com is sponsoring me to make it, but the actual sword is going to be auctioned off for Doctors Without Borders at the end of the, once I have it done and stuff. So while the focus of Jared's company is e-commerce development, the NewEthic name is not just a name, it's more of a mission they have, hence things like sponsoring a lunatic to make a giant sword for charity. So, I don't know, you might want to go check those guys out. There'll certainly be a link for them in the description. Ah, let's see how badly off we are on the main plate. Oh, that's not bad at all. Sometimes these are plates, because of the length of them, they'll have a bowl that's a full 5 millimeters out in the middle. But yeah, that's 1 mil. There's only 1 mil of deflection over that middle. Now my guess is that's still enough for you to. Yeah, that's well enough for you to see. But that's nothing like terrible. That should be easy to fix. So after one with the bottle jack. Oh, now that's strange. There seems to be no deflection now. I'm going to cast my eye down it. Let's see, does it actually look straight? It does not. So there's a small little curve I can't measure in it. So I'm going to give it a couple more turns. The rest I do by sight. So as always, that was a little bit more finicky than I thought it was going to be, but it's flat now. Flat, flat, flat. A goddamn shoe broke. This bit was held on with, it wasn't a molded part of the over like it has been on previous ones. It was held on with stitches. Why? And I guess some plasma stuff. The point of these plates, as well as protecting your boot from hard impact, is they also stop your laces from burning out. But if the actual plate is stitched on, come on. Is that in? Get this one in. Is that in? Okay, they're in. Now I'm gonna take this thing. Okay, so now this guy is held in. Now the big question is, will the other side of these rivets interfere with me being able to walk around? If they do, I'll just pop them off and start again. Oh, no, that's too bad. Yeah, that's fine. Maybe if something landed on it. No, I can't feel the other side of those rivets. That's fine.
Okay, so this is my little chunk of Mike's next Buster Sword build. I am doing the little tube pieces that go between the handle and the guard and the butt cap. So for the handle transition piece, I'm using this. This is obviously some ridiculously thick-walled tubing. This has 1 7/8 outer diameter and about 3/4 inch inner diameter, give or take. I'm using this because this way I don't have to drill it out. I had it handy, and it's not that difficult to cut through. The other thing I'm going to be doing is, since not all the pictures that we found on the internet really are giving a great idea of how long this piece should be in terms of, you know, that big or that big or that big, nobody knows. I'm going to be doing a couple of them to try and narrow down and get it right to where Mike's happy with it. Okay, slightly different setup here since I last showed what was going on the video. This is the piece that is going to be the sleeve, and this is a monstrosity of my own creation. Boring bar, also made by yours truly. So this has interchangeable carbide tips, because I managed to get a bunch of them on eBay, so why not? And this thing, that's just the boring bar holder I put together. It works beautifully, so I really can't complain. What I'm doing right now is I am making this hole much bigger. So right now we are at about 1 inch, and it needs to be 1 1/4 inches overall. So I'm going to go ahead and cut that once while you guys are watching. Additionally, with this setup, since it's much more rigid, I can get away with heavier cuts and higher speed.
Previous incarnations of the Crisis Core Buster Sword, which is where these marks came from,
kind of. I won't get into it. It was in Advent Children first, but the I've just etched it into the surface. But I was thinking with this one to bump it out more to make it more 3D. I was going to do them as separate plates and then weld them to the surface. So that's what all these little paper templates are. I have to cut out each of these pieces individually out of 1/8 inch, and then drill holes at all of the the cornery bits, and then I'm going to weld into those holes and then grind back. It's way more work, but hopefully it'll look better. If it doesn't look better, then yeah, giant waste time. So cutting out these shapes is a relatively small margin of error, so I want new eyes. These are actually quite good compared to when I normally change them out. But just, I don't want to have to waste time recutting things. I think even a millimeter out, because these guys are so close to each other, even a millimeter out will be noticeable. The main danger when I stick the new lenses in is I often have to do a double take about whether or not I'm actually wearing them. You know, I sometimes start to grind thinking I'm still wearing them, but I've shoved them up into my forehead and I just don't realize. Because for the first little while after they're just freshly put in, there is no difference. My brain has learned to delete all the other parts of the goggles, as the human brain often does. If you're doing stuff yourself and struggling, oftentimes it's not, I found at least for me starting off, it wasn't a case of manual dexterity or anything like messing up cuts and stuff, but just being like light levels and being able to see. It's exactly as important as you think it is, you know? Nothing beats a fresh pair of lenses. I'm going to start by cutting a line here, and then using the plasma cutter to separate these pieces into three so that I have better access to all the ins and outs. I even have shiny new gloves. Thanks, Shanna. Rub. That's the part where I missed with the grinder, although it's only very surface. And here there was a bigger one, so I buzzed it just to make sure it was only on the surface. I'm going to put these in the vinegar now and take all the scale off, so this won't matter so much. I have a master plan. That was a lot of little fiddly bits. It would have probably been cleverer to get them laser cut, but you know, this just operates as proof that if you don't have a laser cutter, etc., 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 you can make them by hand.
I was a little bit worried about how the transfer piece, that sleeve bit that I'm doing for Mike, would hold up to being turned on the lathe. So I spent a little bit of time and I made myself a thing. This is the thing I made. This is just a hair under the inner diameter of what this is, and this is just a hair over 1 1/4 inches, which is what Mike said the handle is gonna be. So, great. So this goes right on there, and I made a nut. 1 inch, 8 threads per inch. 1 inch, 8 threads per inch. And my comically ancient adjustable Ford Model T wrench. Not kidding, it really is that old. I think this one actually has the Model T stamp on it yet, but eh. So, this will hold the sleeve in place, and it will support the inside wall of it marginally. It's going to support it a heck of a lot more than me just gripping it in the chuck jaws and leaving a little bit down here and then cutting it off at the end. I'm much more comfortable with this. The other thing I have here, this is my little poor man's travel dial indicator, because cheap from Harbor Freight, and 1 inch square stock that I took a hacksaw to and then filed the rest of the way to make it work. So this will clamp onto the Gibbs, or not the Gibbs, excuse me, the ways here, which are nice and triangular. So essentially, it'll go on like that, and this piece will turn 90 degrees and be under here. So that way I can actually accurately measure it out to, you know, 0.3 inches, 0.6 inches, 0.1 inch, whatever. Well, as you can see, that's the handle transition piece done. And when I was bringing this down to the correct radius, I went ahead and just started way back here. So I also shaved the quarters off of that very large nut that I made. So now all I have to do is take the nut off, and this bit will more or less be done. So plan B for removing the nut. Okay, there we go. Got it loose. I needed something to support the chuck here so it wouldn't allow itself to kick over. So, did a wooden block between here and one of the jaws, and that worked very nicely for supporting it and stopping it from turning. So, now I just have to do the butt cap. Toodles!
Let's start off by cutting out these diamonds and then setting up the die grinder table to get the rest of that semicircle. It's not a full semicircle, it's a partial section out of a circle. Last time I made these, it was out a quarter inch. These are 3/16. It's because this thing, there's a thing at the back, the materia guard, and it's only a half inch high. So I was worried that if this was quarter and then this little piece that goes on top of it is a quarter, it would be completely flush with the surface. And the picture makes it look like there's a step down. So 3/16, hardly anyone will tell. So there's 3/16 and 3/16, and we'll still have the 1/8 inch. So we'll have that step.
Okay, so I've got it started on the butt cap for the thing. This is, well, was originally 2 inch round stock. This is my terribly undersized 3-jaw chuck. Normally on my South Bend here, I use that larger 4-jaw you saw. I've got a 3-jaw that's just a hair bigger than my 4-jaw, but that 3-jaw does not currently have jaws. So, yeah. Anyway, all I've done so far is I've got the outside of this cleaned up. I've got the backside here faced off, so it's exactly at 90 degrees to this. And I've got this face also done, so it's at 90 degrees to the side here. So I'm going to be taking this down to 3/4 of an inch, if memory serves. I'm going to check my drawing before I do. But right now, it's just a hair under 2 inches. Some of you guys were complaining that I am going dreadfully slow on this old machine when I was doing the hammer with Mike. Well, there's a reason, and you can actually see on this, and when I start turning this piece, I'm actually taking off 50 thousandths at a pass until I get roughly down to the dimension I want. The reason I didn't do that on the hammer, this is mild steel, so it's nowhere near as hard, and it's also not, you know, this diameter. You know, out here, I'm not having to have most of my tooling hanging off the side of my lathe. If I had a bigger lathe, yeah, I could probably get away with blowing through it as aggressively as some of you guys were expecting me to. But, I'm not going to complain about what I got because I have a lathe. I'm kind of proud of that. Anyway, I'm rambling again. Moving on. Okay, just a quick check-in. That's the butt cap so far. I've got this piece trimmed down to 1 1/4 inches, and I went ahead and roughly cut the dome using the compound. I just kept changing the angle on it to get it rough, and then I went through with a file to get it cleaned up and nice and round. I made sure to leave enough down here in the corner here and enough of a straight edge on the side before it starts doming that I can actually fit it in here and grip this down. So now, all I've got to do is drill a pilot hole in this and then ream it out to 1.25 and 3/4 of an inch deep and bevel the back edge of it. I'll probably go ahead and bevel the back edge of it and mark off where this piece needs to be in terms of overall length, but that's where I'm at right now. This is called a deming bit. Believe it or not, they're not horribly expensive. They're not horribly cheap either, but you can get them. Okay, that is the butt cap done. So my part in all this is complete. Now I just have to ship these off to Mike, and he will do something with them. Hopefully it will be amazing. Pretty sure it will be. Bye.
Evil never got sick and tired of Bob Ross drawing trees and bushes, so now we're going to anchor around some steel. Gonna use this edge because I think that was the guillotine edge on the bit I cut it from, so it'll be a little bit straighter. And very carefully.
this one a little bit over this way. And that should be good enough.
So remember someone in one of the comments chastising me for the use of the Sharpie to mark out where my things are going to go. I don't find the Sharpie too bad, but the thing that always distresses me is making sure these center punch marks go where I tell them to. They're always good by normal standards, I guess, but I get a little bit fussy about them being in the exact spot where the crosshairs land. So I have the drill turned down as low as it can go, 300, 400, what is it? It's telling me 400, but who knows how accurate that is. I wish I could turn it down even lower. So here we go, these are pilot holes, and the theory is they help guide the big drill through, and this big bar is clamped across the back. When the drill, when it catches, will want to push the bar this way. So the idea is this bar will stop it from spinning round. Or something horrible will happen and I'll wind up with loads of broken fingers. Who knows? The rare appearance of cutting oil in one of my videos. I'll have to clean them up before I do anything else with them. But these holes were a little bit too big to get away with not using the oil, you know? So these balls aren't perfectly the 3/4 inch advertised, nor did they go through. You know, they're not spherical, blah, blah, blah. So I'm having to, like, I don't know, can you see this? I got my torch on a little thing so that I can look and see the gap all around and then try to even out the gap. Some of these balls were, like, really badly off. Like this one, for instance, I had to weld on and put in the drill and then grind to get it to go through the hole. And now it's just barely going through. And then some other ones are baggy. I'm presuming the holes drilled actual, presuming the drill made round holes, these little balls aren't actually round because I can see they're touching off corners while not touching off other places and blah blah blah. So that's what I'm doing. I'm shining a light underneath to try and even it out. I was getting kind of toasty welding the things. I could feel my arms burning, so I'm going to try out these new differently Ableton sleeves I got. So that's the back of them ground. Whoop. So now they're not quite flat. Despite clamping it, there's a slight curve that I'm going to have to beat out of them. But see all the color from the welds? And I guess the fact that the not perfectly in the center of those holes, that the holes are bigger than the balls doesn't actually matter too much. Look fine when it's cleaned up, probably. I was worried that this one would look different because this was the one that I had to take down, make smaller to get in the hole. But once the steel wire brush hit it, there's hardly any difference, you know.
God, I didn't record myself cutting these guys out because I thought it might be a bit boring because they were all straight strips. But then you can say, oh, if you didn't record yourself cutting them out, how, because you thought it was going to be boring, how interesting is it really for you to be taking them out of the vinegar bath? To which I say, that's fair. But at least this is quicker and you get to see them all at once. So now I'm welding these strips on like this, but I had to make up this quite elaborate rig in order to, set up everything properly. So those tacks are, relatively strong, but what I want to do now is grind these and weld into it. It doesn't need that much of anything. Actually, that's wrong. The bottom half, the half that's like here, where the handle is, it'll be good if that part is strong. But the rest of it doesn't need much of anything. And then that goes there. Like that, and then we have these little side pieces. Where's the other one? There it is. Like so. And then it gets welded in from the side, and then welded all along the bottom. That's what the back of it looks like. So now the back of this one is flat, that I can go splunk, and it's the sword. And then it actually gets joined to the blade on the sides and on the bottom. These ones just took the grinder and zip, and then the weld is inside the grinder mark. Despite my best efforts, the heat has left a slight warp in it. Now, hopefully, make sure these guys are somewhat equidistant. I have a piece of wood with a slot cut out of it so that I don't have to hammer directly on the pseudo rivet, that I can hammer such that it lands on the edges, which are the part that are keeping it slightly warped anyway, because that's where it originated. One and done. It only needed a tiny little bit.
I mean, I'm sure it's not like mathematically straight focus. It's not focusing. But it's straight enough to put on the blank and we won't notice any. And this guy, I bent the piece of steel slightly too long, so this won't slide in here now. See that gap? It is. I can cut it to whatever it exactly needs to be. Obviously, if being short would have just been stupid, because then I would have had to cut the entire thing again.
Last time I did this was with the MIG welder, which leaves a lot of material and is very aggressive. So it's nice being able to do it with the TIG welder a couple of years later. How do I get this last little bit? These are only very delicate welds, but these things don't face any real force exerted on them, or at least they shouldn't. I mean, they're pretty strong. Really, you should use a bit of filler rod when you're doing it, but these welds are so, you know, this is more like gas welding, what I did.
I had forgotten how hard these guys are to line up with each other.
Whoa, that was very fiddly. Lots of clamping and unclamping and little wood blocks and stuff. But yeah, they're lined up to the best of my ability on the surface. Yeah, and those welds, much neater with the TIG welder nowadays. There's another little part, that little nugget where I go, this guy that I want to stick in here. But before, I might flip it just to show you what I'm doing now. Oy! These things, I don't know what you'd call them, they're almost like a version of the things that were on the top of the brass parts of the Crisis Core version. Another silly thing, because they butt directly up against this guy here, I wanted to tack them on now. Now let's see, can I get this out without everything breaking? There we go. So I'm going to weld these from underneath, grind back, you know, just a couple of zaps along, doesn't need that much, so that then I can put it back in. Perfect fit. But for the moment, these guys are only held on tiny little welds here on the edges. I have to clamp a flat piece across, etc., etc. This one is keeping those two bars flat against each other and flat against the surface. This one is keeping this top fatter bar flat against this guy, which has been held on by this one, which keeps all of those flat against the back of this surface. And then this one is keeping the skinnier bar flat against the surface. So that's four clamps doing different things so that I can get a weld. Whoa, don't move. Across the back of these guys and here, in here, and have it still go back in the right place. And the datum, the thing that's just keeping them in the right position, is these two tiny little delicate welds that I have to be careful not to bend here. Plan A was I was going to weld all of this guy around and have this permanently attached first,
before I started joining any of the plates to the surface. But this very first plate, it's going to be nearly impossible to clean up these wells. So I think I'm going to attach it first and then, grind these little plug wells back and then attach this guy. This is what I'm talking about. This guy I'm using, the drill with the sandpaper on it. It would have been impossible to get that in had this guy already been welded here, you know? So, that's the start. I'll just keep working my way up the surface with all the other little plates. So, I've done these three plates, and now I'm about to do this little thin sliver in here, and I'm worried about it because that's a 3/32 plug weld I'm about to attempt. I've never done anything smaller than a quarter. I'm curious how it'll turn out. So what I've done here for this piece is I've done the old holes through to its sister part on the other side and tapped the threads through. And done it through with little 6/32 bolts instead. When I tried to weld it, it ended in disaster, and I had to make another one of these guys. That's the only good thing. You're more likely to have a disaster with the small little pieces, but the little small pieces are relatively easy to make a new one of. So my guess is I'm going to have to do it with. There's another little tiny rectangle piece here too, but it's annoying. Having to do stuff like that. Lining those two bits up was the hardest part. You know, clamping them so that I could do that. And then I had to plasma cut the holes through on the bottom because the small drill bit wasn't able to go through the Hardox, especially because it was a older one. It just goes on and on and on. So I don't know. I don't think I actually got any of it on film, but after putting in that little piece, the TIG welder stopped working. Just completely and utterly, I could get into what was wrong with it. It was reading like it was only receiving half power, which normally is a problem with the leads, that there's something disconnected. But after a thorough inspection of the leads, after bringing it into my house so I could hook it up to the dryer circuit to make sure it wasn't a problem with the breaker on the wall, it's something wrong with the TIG welder inside. So I've sent the TIG welder away to be looked at, which means I'm a little bit stuck for how I'm going to do this bit. But, I'm going to have to figure something out. I've also attached this little piece with the small 6/32 bolts. And then I'm going to grind the heads off those. Actually, where's my tripod? I think I left it back at my house. So I'll just... Oh, wait, you can see here. So you can see what the tops of the heads look like on this guy. That's before being fully polished up. So they grind away. There was a little countersink that these guys, the tops of these heads go into. The tops of these heads, the reason I'm using the flat heads is, will that guy focus for me? Probably not. Come on. It's too far away. There we go. You can see the top of the flat head. Top of the flat head. Doesn't go down that far. You can grind away a lot of the head. You can drill a countersink, tighten this down into the countersink, and grind away the top of the head and have it be invisible, not have to worry about the Phillips head ones go super deep to account for the pointiness. So here we are at my buddy's place. Artist by the name of Barney Zeitz, who I used to work for. Ooh.
There he is working on a window. It's probably too small for you guys to see. He built those windows. But that technique I use in some of my videos, where beaten shapes and then welding in between the shapes.
What did you say?
Barney's the guy I learned that from. Hello, Barney.
My friend is here.
So Barney has a TIG welder, and he's going to let me use it to account for the music. Wouldn't it be funny if the Google spiders caught that 10 seconds of music and then didn't allow me to monetize the entire...
I had a little issue with that, yes.
Yeah.
Myself. But, nice to see you.
You too. These are the windows Barney is currently working on. Do you want to, if you hit the, can you turn the music off completely? It might mess up with the, you might be just clearer to hear you. Barney, tell the good people what you're doing.
Yes. I've been commissioned by a church in Germany that used to be a synagogue, so they call it a church, former synagogue, to do a series of windows that will remember the fact that Jewish people lived in this town for 500 years and now there's none. It's a very heartfelt story. A woman from Cambridge who was Jewish went to see where her dad had been a child, and she met the pastor of the church. This was 3 years ago, and he was so moved to meet somebody whose father had been a child there, and he's only in his 40s, so you know, he never knew anybody. So they stayed in touch, and they decided to form a committee and find an artist that could do windows in both Jewish and Christian themes. So she found me.
Yeah.
It's been an awesome trip. So
cool. And for anybody who wants to, is curious about this and about Barney in general, there will be a link in the description for you to follow to check out his stuff.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we are past welding. Oh my God, did all the different stuff we've did, you know, going into churches and taking windows out. We actually have another set here. What a nightmare we've done.
Yeah, no, I spent
28 out of 40 of them. Oh my God.
No, I spent many years helping Barney do this kind of stuff. I mean, like, he got me, theoretically, my job was to go do the welding stuff for, like, you know, the frames and stuff, and also all the art type mm-hmm. stuff I saw in the garden outside. But yeah, I wound up doing lots of the stained glass stuff too, the taking old windows apart and fixing them.
It was good for the recession, I must say. It kept us going, kept me going.
Yeah.
Anyway, so, here's our messy shop.
Yeah, I like it. Lots of stuff. I hope my shop looks as good as this someday. It's not quite there yet.
That's great.
One of the tripod legs is in the way of me sanding it, but you get the idea. I'm just using the sandpaper thing in the drill. Sandpaper wheel? I don't know what you call it.
and just take off all the grinder marks. When it's down to just sandpaper marks, like these guys up here, they're easier to then take off by hand. They're much easier to take off by hand than the swirlies left by the sanding disc. About this Buster Sword Redux design that I have qualms about is there used to be this faux hinge type thing that used to extend down here, but because they put the 5-stud guard on, the back of the faux hinge is gone. There's this little vestigial bit of it left. I used to quite like making the faux hinge. If you can go to the previous video I did, I think it's called How a Buster Sword is Built. It was the first one of these big long build videos I uploaded. It's too hot to touch and I'm trying to draw a line around it. You can see it, it's I might just upload a little bit of it. Ah! Where's my gloves? Here is we put this guy, it was two sides, I decided to flat on this guy. We put this guy down. And then we slide these guys back and then we position these guys just so. So the thin marks line up, which I know isn't great, but it's all I got. And then okay, so we do that. Take this guy away. And then as carefully as we can. And then I'm going to weld it on the back. And then maybe on the underneath too. Grinding those four spot welds is going to be a pain in the ass, so I'll probably do that at home. Oh man, I've been here for hours now. We're down to the last weld, or the last TIG weld anyway. When I'm putting on the handle and stuff, I'll use the big welder, I guess. And then the collar pieces. Back here. The collar pieces I was going to TIG weld, but I have to MIG weld them, I have to MIG weld them. I left this weld to last because it will make the thing very hot and then I won't be able to interact with it properly for a while. Thank you. Oh, gonna have to wait till it cools down a bit. Dagnabbit. That's the TIG welder, compared to the size of the one I usually use. It's hard to say which is better. That one, by the numbers, gets up to bigger heat, but it cuts out and overheats. So, that's all the welding done. The TIG welding, or it should be, unless stuff goes wrong. Something will go wrong. I'll wind up having to drag this thing back here. These two wells and these two wells are very hard to grind. For these two guys at the back, I could just about get these ones at the front with a little modified sanding pad thing I made. But these guys at the back, I just couldn't get them with anything. And then I remembered I had these stones that I hardly ever use for anything. So that's what I used to take those guys down. I just could not reach them with anything else. I remember I thought before I did this that I would be able to reach them with the sander. But I think those calculations were based on this guy, the guard, not being there. And then once the guard's there, it just becomes a nightmare. I couldn't reach it at all. These little corners where it comes in. If I had a brand new grinding disc, I might be able to get it pretty quick, but I don't. I'm gonna do a dangerous thing, which you probably shouldn't do except in extreme situations. Where I use a cutting disc, more like a grinding disc. This is bad for several reasons. The grinding discs are thick, designed to take that sideways action. The cutting discs you have to keep straight because they're thin and brittle, and if they break while spinning, it's a disaster. I just need to get it close enough that I can get the rest of it with a file. So, that should do it. Because of the light in here at the moment, there's all these textures that the artificial light is bringing out, but I don't think they're much of anything to worry about. I think the sandpaper will get all those out. There's a thing there that, because of the light, looks like a dip, but I can't feel it with my finger, so I think it's good. These other bits I can get from standing it up just from the side. It's just this bit in here that's always a pain in the ass. Where's my stepladder? I hate doing this grinding in the workshop. I'd much prefer to do it outside, but it's raining and it's dark, so that's two reasons. Too hard to touch. You can see I missed a spot here, so I'm gonna have to patch that up. But other than that, the TIG weld was very clean. And this up here, it wasn't a
You know, it's not a bubble. It's just where, like, there was a weird undercut, which I should have caught. It was my fault I didn't.
Yeah, these little guys here, absolute nightmare to, you know, largely too big for the grinders. You can kind of get some of this big stuff with the sanding pad, but a lot of this was carefully nipping stuff with the thin cutting disc and then just going in with an iron file.
Because Mark machined these parts, they're actually 1 1/4 on the inside. The bar was a little bit more because of the, you know, just the scale and stuff. So that's what I was doing, why I was shining. Even though no one will see this ever again, I was shining it up just so that these guys would actually fit. So I spent quite a long time dicking around with this to make sure that the handle is 90 degrees to the guard. Although really you can only trust that to a certain level, because remember, this surface is a surface I created by grinding, you know? So the chance of it being perfectly flat is basically zero. And then measuring that it was actually, it was an equal distance between here and here and here and here. Yet again, that's a little bit tricky because these surfaces were created by grinding. Then visual check, just to, like, that it looks like when you cast your eye down it, that the two materia slots line up with the handle, and as near as I can tell, they can. I also did a stepping on the stepladder and looking down at it, and that also seemed to check out. So now, after all of that, I'm confident enough to do the first tack. Now, I wish I had my TIG welder so that I could do that first tack, you know, like deep in there with the TIG welder. But, you know, I've welded a whole mess of other handles onto blades with my MIG welder, and none of them have ever come off in use, quote unquote. So I think it'll be fine to do this bevel weld and grind with the MIG welder. Now, while it's in a configuration where it would still be relatively easy to undo, were it incorrect, I'm going to use a secondary method to check what I've done. So, this is an angle iron with a specific cutout on it. Obviously, I checked that the angle iron was still straight after doing the cutout. So this goes flat against the blade, the edge of the blade, I should say, and then I clamp it down. And the idea is, I think I'm pretty sure last time I did this, I did a completely different thing. But in general, every single time I do stuff, I do it completely differently. So this isn't too unusual. Get this guy, make sure this guy is actually that. So now this thing is flat and 90 degrees. And this thing is giving us a datum where the edge of the sky is. And we get a reading, a number. Now the measurements are the wrong way around because nothing on earth can be simple.
It's measuring 196 from the back of this guy. And we have, it's just under 196 at the back. So, I think that's good enough. You'd have to be an awfully big cleany pants to complain about half a millimeter. I mean, I am half tempted to fix it. How would I fix it? Oh, I've already thought up of a way to fix it. Damn your brain! Ah! I'll plant something from here to here and squeeze it a bit.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's not that many clamps, actually. But what I did there was clamp the sword to the piece of angle iron so it couldn't move. And then clamp the angle or piece of angle iron down to this guy so it can't move. And then I undid this guy and then give this one a little squeeze. And then reclamp this guy. Actually, technically, this one isn't doing anything because now this one is holding it in that half millimeter closer position. So now the edge of the blade is granted that this guy remains straight throughout all that, is 100% parallel with the side of the handle. Plus or minus little lumpy bumpinesses in the steel. One half of it done. Ah, come on. There we go. Get the other half from underneath. I was doing little zaps here to not have to grind this guy down to this level. So I wanted to not have a weird transition here. And then I'll get the other half of it from the other side. It's important when you're welding into the bevel to actually, I mean, this is tricky, to actually get at the bottom of the bevel. Like if the bevel was too narrow, it'd be very easy to go and have a cavity below the level of the bevel, which is what you want to like 100% avoid. I mean, I'm not sure how fatal it would be, but obviously it's stronger if it doesn't have a big hole in it, you know, like if it's actually welded all the way through. Mark's thing. Originally I was going to TIG weld this around, but seeing as there's a leather wrap here going up, I think I'm just going to go, I mean I've done this with other collars in the past, maybe die grind a piece out on either side and go zap zap and just have two big tacks hold it on, because this isn't really load bearing. This thing's primary function at this point is just to hide the slightly uneven part where I've ground away the big ass weld. So what I'm doing here is I use some of the soot. I actually did it for the main plate as well. Some of the soot from the oxyacetylene is kind of anti-spatter. Like I was saying before, this isn't how I would do this if my TIG welder was still working, but seeing as it's not, I've also, I don't know, there's no way for me to show you, the two spots where I'm going to zap, I took the die grinder and did a big gouge onto the bar. So that the weld, when I grind it away to tidy it up, I'm not grinding away weld that's actually holding stuff. Oh, there we go.
Perfect. Whew. This one was a little bit messier than the one on the top. That's those tacks ground and filed down so that they look relatively neat. And then once I wrap the leather around the handle, you won't, in theory, see anything at all, because that was the idea of welding into a hole. Welding into a groove was that I could grind back without worrying that I was weakening them, you know? So now all that's left to do is the sharpening. It's very hard to keep the surface flat. Try to keep it as flat as you can so that when you go with the next step, the sandpaper, it doesn't have to do a huge amount of work to get this down and perfectly smooth. That's one side done.
So what I've done now in preparation for the blackening tomorrow is I've masked off all the parts of the blade I don't want to turn black. And so hopefully when I do my thing tomorrow, I'm not quite sure what I'm doing, so hopefully it works. So the plan, such as it is this guy is now boiling, but it's percolating. I'm going to spray this guy with the cold blue. This is just three bottles of that gun blue. If it was jet black, I would have probably sent it to those guys I know at the black oxide, sorry, there's smoke in my eyes, place. But because it's more of a greyish color, I'm gonna use this stuff, which is not as good as getting it, you know, done by professionals, obviously. But the Buster Sword kind of traditionally looks a little bit beaten up and splotchy anyway. So this I think will be good for the look of it. Then the plan is once I spray it and let it do its thing, to then transfer it to the bath. I think you're supposed to use cold water, but I'm worried this thing has so many nooks and crannies. To limit the weird stuff with the nooks and crannies, the boiling water percolates, so it'll get into all the nooks and crannies just by swishing itself around its own movement. Then when I pull it out and transfer it to this guy, well, I can talk about that next part, but it involves spraying it with this stuff I got sent. This Rust Patrol stuff, which is supposedly better than WD-40, but I guess we're going to test that now. And then hopefully tomorrow when I come out to look at it and go, oh yeah, it's not covered in big rusty patches, which is the main thing I'm worried about.
So, I already dried the other side. And obviously while I was drying the other side, I couldn't dry this side. But see, it's bright red, right? El Desastro. So, let's see, does this stuff help? Ah! My suspicion was correct. That superficial rust on the surface was the remains of the water. The water itself is rusty from me using that trough so much. That incorruptible stuff, it doesn't smell like WD-40, it has a different smell, and it had a different kind of foaming quality. Like, I'm not in a position to say what that means, but this is what I'm talking about. It's not jet black. What I want is kind of a splotchy kind of look. So there's it with all the tape removed. I had to use a lot of acetone to get the all the sticky stuff from the duct tape off, but it worked. So the idea is I'm cutting a strip 1 1/4 inches. There's only the tiniest amount of source material available for the actual game. So this is based on squinting at a handful of traders. It used to look more like a red color, especially the first version of it in the game. But I think the new game has a more realistic color palette, and I think they've changed it to more like a brown heading towards red as opposed to bright red. But anyway, this is the closest thing I could get. So this is what we're using. So this is a faux handle of the same diameter, so I can do this messing around here without having to do it on the sword. So that's the end. You're holding the sword, and it's heavy, a heavy-ass sword, so it's gonna slide through your hands. So we'll wrap it this way with this being the yeah, that's right, this is the top. So, I'm going to do a cut here. Now, will I do the cut this away? That's working. And boom, we can tuck this in at the top.
This is the sword a day later. The thing I was most worried about was with the drenching it in the acid, the blackening solution, the gun blue, and then literally soaking it in water, that we'd run into rust issues. I was especially worried about the edges of these little plates and stuff, because, you know, like, there was opportunity for both the acid and the water to get in there. But this spray can of stuff, it wasn't like a big huge trough, it was just a spray can. But as you can see, 24 hours later, there seems to be no rust on it. And on further inspection, this stuff, it's thicker than WD-40. It's a little bit sticky. It's more like, it reminds me a little bit of Koji oil. Not in how effective it is, because I am not impressed with Koji oil myself, but how in just the stickiness, the thickness, it's thicker than WD-40. Which, so it would make sense that it was more effective. One would think that it was harder to spray if it was thicker, but it seemed to spray on okay. Although it did foam like crazy more, so it might use a more volatile or violent chemical to get itself going. But yeah, there you go, thicker WD-40. Pop rivet into a hole I drilled. I would have liked to get it a little bit closer, have it more centered, but there you go. It's hard, very hard to freehand drill into a curved surface, so that's why it's a little bit weird. Ah, nope.
previous incarnations of the Buster Sword. I think it would be a bit vague about how the handle is wrapped. You know, like you can see that it's whatever color, but then it's been like a little bit strange as to like what material is wrapping it and how. But for the current one, if you look at the trailer for the remake, it's very unambiguously a leather wrap doing this kind of thing. Looks a bit skinnier than my handle, I've noticed, but I'd be nervous about putting a skinnier handle on this guy. I've done it in the past, but this is such a heavy sword. Actually, I don't have a weight yet, but over 50 pounds would be my guess. Because I hit off the tripod leg, I don't think it caught the last part. I haven't flicked through it. But so that's locked down there. And then this last bit is going to be glue. The only part of it that's glue. And then the rest of it is just raw kinetic. How tight it is. I use this stuff. The contact cement. The horrible nasty stuff. The stinky stuff. Because it was new. I hit it with the heat gun as well. Before squashing it together. So hopefully that'll hold. You know, I cut around here to try and match the contour of this guy so there wouldn't be a weird blump blump, you know. Like I mentioned at the top of the video, this month's sword is a charity item courtesy of the guys at New Ethic. If you want to check those guys out, there's a link in the description. So the opening bid on this charity item will be the amount I would have to charge for it were I to be making it for just a customer. Now, I probably won't be making this one again because with the Patreon gig I have going, I have to keep making a new and different sword every month. So this could be your only opportunity to own this sword for the foreseeable future. So if you would like to make a bid and make the world a little bit less awful, there'll be details in the video description of how you can contact me, etc, etc, etc. Because this item is a lot pricier than my usual charity bills, I'll probably be letting it go all the way out till the middle of December, something like that. I'll decide on a date. The date will be in the video description too, and probably video annotations, etc, etc. So if you would like to own this sword, send me an email.